very glad and honored to be here today to talk about this book, and I'm very grateful to all the organizers, and in particular to my publisher, Fondo de Cultura, who makes this book now available in the Spanish language. So this is, you know, the title of the book is Capital in the 21st Century, but now that you're in the room, I can tell you the truth, which is that this is mostly about the past and very little about the 21st century. And I am much better at analyzing the past than the future. So I, you know, I try to draw conclusions for the future in my book, but you know, you can very much disagree with all of my conclusions and still find the historical narrative that's at the core of this book of some interest. So the, you know, this is really a book, you know, in this book I study the global dynamics of income and wealth inequality since 18th century in over 20 countries. And what's really new, I think, about the book is that for the first time we were able to collect a lot of historical data on income and wealth. And, you know, I want to apologize that Latin America and Chile is not present in the book as much as I would like it to be. But on the other hand, it's not entirely my fault. It's also because access to historical fiscal data in Latin America was not as easy as I would like it to be, and we are certainly trying hard to extend our work today to more emerging countries. I should be clear about the fact that we still know too little. You know, we have made a lot of effort with a very large team of international economists, and, you know, in particular Tony Atkinson in Britain, Emmanuel Saez, who's at Berkeley, Facundo Alvaredo, who's from Argentina, who is somewhere in the room, I think, but I can't see Facundo. But anyway, he has played a very important role in the collection of the historical data that I will, some of which is, I will show you today. We still know too little, as I said. You know, at least we have made a little bit of progress, but you know, we are in the social sciences, so there's always different ways to interpret historical evolution. And again, you know, I don't ask you to share all of my conclusions. The main objective of the book is to allow readers to contribute in a more informed way to our democratic discussion and to make their own mind about these important issues. So in this presentation, you know, I will present some results from the book, but of course I cannot present everything. So if you want to have a sense of the material that's covered in the book, please have a look at this website where you will find all the statistical series and graphs and figures that are covered in the book. And by going through the list of figures and tables, you will have a good sense of the kind of material that's covered in the book, and maybe you will want to read the book after or not, you know, whatever. So the book is both about income and about wealth, and so to a large extent the book is trying to shift the attention from income inequality to wealth inequality, which I think in the long run is even more important than income inequality. But of course the two are important, and the two are very much related. When you have higher inequality of income, this tends to lead later on to higher inequality of wealth, because wealth partly comes from the accumulation of saving out of income. But wealth is a more complicated object because it also involves inherited wealth, it involves natural resources which were not saved by anyone, and it's typically much more concentrated than income. So it creates social tension and political conflicts that is even, you know, more difficult to solve in a peaceful manner than income inequality. So let me start by describing some of the data on income, and then I will move to wealth. So the data on income that we have put together in this research is available online in this webpage, the World Top Income Database. So the countries in red, well, they are not really red here, but let's say the countries in black are already in the database, and the countries in blue, or, you know, in a clearer color, are about to enter the database. So, you know, we are trying to cover as many countries as possible in the world. We still have to make progress for Latin America, but, you know, we are trying to make progress, and I will come back later to the case of Argentina. So what does it mean to be in the database? It means that we have tried to collect all the historical data on incomes that we could find for a given country. And usually the oldest data source on income comes from the income tax itself. So it's important to have in mind that taxation is always more than just taxation. It's also a way to produce information about society. It's a way to define legal categories and statistical categories. So when you don't have an income tax in the 19th century, you don't have any information about income. So, you know, in France, before the creation of the income tax in 1914, in the 19th century, you had the contribution des portes et fenêtres, the contribution based on doors and windows. So you have all sorts of fascinating statistics on the number of doors and windows in the different departments in France, which is absolutely fascinating, but it's less interesting in a way than to study income groups. The modern income tax was created in 1914 in France, 1913 in the United States, 1932 in Argentina. In many Latin American countries, it was in the interwar period. In 1908, the British transformed their proportional income tax into a progressive income tax. In some countries, it was a bit earlier. In Japan, Germany, and in a number of Nordic European countries, it was in around 1890, sometimes 1800. By and large, it's between 1900 and 1920 that the income tax is introduced pretty much everywhere. So usually, this is where we start for our study of income. When we study wealth, we can go back to the 19th century and sometimes to the 18th century because the taxation of wealth and property is older than the taxation of income. You know, you need to tax wealth even if it's at very low rate at the time of transmission of wealth, either when you transmit wealth to the next generation or when you sell property, because you need to register property. So again, taxation is not just taxation. It's also a way to organize economic activity, and it's useful to have property titles to organize the economy, and having a registration tax at the time you establish a property title is usually the way it works. So in France, for instance, the modern tax on inheritance was instituted by the French Revolution, and this is why we can go back to the 18th century or the late 18th century, very early 19th century, when we study wealth in France. But for income, we have to start around 1900, 1910, 1920, depending on the country. So here is what we find. You know, this is one particular example of what we find with a particularly spectacular evolution for the US. So on you will find similar graphs for every country that are in red on this website. So I'm not going to show you every country, but let me show you one example. So what is this? This is a simple indicator of income inequality. This is the share of total income going to the top 10% in the US with or without capital gains. Okay, so capital gains are the income you make by selling your shares on the stock market, typically. So it's a very important form of income for very top income groups with stock options, etc. And so that's a very cyclical component of income. You know, when you have a stock market boom, you have more capital gains. When you have a stock market crash in 2001, 2, or 2008, 9, you have a decline in capital gains. But you can see that the general evolution is the same with or without capital gains. So let me explain a little bit, you know, what we can learn from this figure. So first of all, if you look at the orders of magnitude, so you can see the share of total income going to the top 10% goes from about one half, you know, 50% of total income in 1928 or 2007, or even in 2012, a bit more than 50%, 51%. And the smaller level are, you know, between 30 and 35%. These are the typical orders of magnitude you have around the world across time for income inequality. It goes from, you know, very unequal country will have 50% or sometimes even a bit more than 50% in some Latin American countries like Brazil. You'll see later. And the lowest inequality level are typically 25% in some Scandinavian countries of total income going to the top 10. Now, you can see there are large fluctuations over time. So you have this big decline in inequality between the 1920s and the 1950s, then a stabilization during the 50s, 60s, 70s, and then a big rise starting around 1980. Now, the big decline during the first half of the 20th century is exactly what Kuznets found in the 1950s. So Kuznets and this finding gave rise to the so-called theory of the Kuznets curve. So Kuznets was an American economist who was the first to compute national accounts for the US, GDP, national income statistics in the interwar period, which was very important because at that time there was no official national account. So we knew there was a big depression in the 30s, but there was no data to measure it, which was sort of problematic. And so initially, these kind of national accounts were computed by academics, and then it was handed over to national institute. And it's a little bit the same process with inequality. At some point, maybe everything will be done by official institute in a sort of mechanical manner, but at this stage, academics are playing a role to produce that kind of data. And so Kuznets was the first economist in the 1950s to use the income tax data for the US in order to compute the change in the share of national income going to the top 10%. And he found a very good news, which was the decline of inequality between the 1920s and the 1950s. So this was a very important finding because this was the first time there was an historical series about inequality. And we've used the same data as Kuznets, and we found exactly the same result. So Kuznets didn't have Excel, but he did the computation right, and we have no disagreement with Kuznets, except that we have more years of data. And so this gives a very different picture, because the very optimistic interpretation of the Kuznets finding and the so-called theory of the Kuznets curve in the 50s and 60s was that basically this was the end of history in the 50s, 60s, that you have a natural reduction of inequality in the advanced stages of development, and then this is the end of history in the sense that you have stabilization of inequality at a relatively low level. And indeed, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, you have this very stable share going to the top 10%, which means that we really were in this sort of ideal of balanced growth of the post-war period. When you have a stable share, it means that everybody grows at the same speed. So if you have 3% GDP growth in 1960, everybody grows at 3%. The average income of the top 10% grows at 3%. The average income of the bottom 90 grows at 3%. So this is the ideal world where, in a way, all what you care about is growth. And if you have more growth, everybody will grow faster. So this is a simple and easy solution. Now, the problem is that in the recent period, it's been very different. The other problem is that, as you can see, the decline in inequality in the first part of the 20th century doesn't look too much like a very steady process. It's a very chaotic process that has a lot to do with the year of World War II, the year of the Great Depression. It's a very complicated and chaotic process. And in fact, Kuznets himself probably did not believe too much in the Kuznets curve. When you read the book of Kuznets, he's very well aware that there are very special reasons, the Great Depression, the National War Labor Board during World War II, which compressed the distribution of wages, the rise of progressive taxation of income and inheritance at that time in the US. So he was very much aware of all these particular reasons for the decline of inequality. But in the post-war period, many people wanted to believe in happy end, at least in capitalist countries, about the dynamics of inequality under capitalism. And people wanted to be able to say, okay, be patient, you should just wait. At some point, the decline of inequality will come together with growth. You just need to wait. Don't make mistakes. Don't become communist. Please be patient. We should always be patient, of course, but of course we need to have good reasons to be patient. And I think it's important now to revisit this history and to understand the very particular reasons that made the decline in inequality possible, and to understand the reasons that made inequality rise again. So in my book, my general conclusion is not that inequality should always decline or should always rise, but rather that there are powerful forces going in all directions, and that ultimately depends very much on the institution and the policies that we choose. So the history of income distribution is not a purely economic history. It is a political, a social, a cultural history. And this is why in my book, I also study the representations of inequality in public debate, including in the literature, because ultimately, these are these representations of inequality that determine the institution and policies that we choose and that determine the rise or the decline in inequality. So So in this particular case, what determines the rise of inequality in the US in recent decades? You know, there's been many policy change after the 1980s in the US, which contribute to this rise of inequality. In particular, when you compare to other developed countries, so if we compare, I'm going to show you the comparison with Europe, and I'm going to move from, so these are, you know, in this presentation and in the book, sometime I show you annual series so that you can see all the short-run chaotic evolution of economic data in relation to the stock market cycle. And sometime I show decennial averages so that we can focus on long-run evolution. And so I think both are important, you know, the short-run and the very long-run are important. So this is a graph where I look at decennial averages, so comparing the rise of inequality in the US. So, of course, for 2010, the decennial average is only 2010-2012, so we will see when we have more data where we go, but apparently this continues to increase. Now, you can see that for Europe, so when I talk about Europe in this graph, this is the GDP-weighted average of Germany, France, Britain, Italy, and Sweden, so it's not quite Europe, but it's a big part of Europe, and most European countries follow a similar pattern. So you can see that the rise of inequality has been much less strong in Europe than in the US. So how can we explain this? Well, probably this shows that you need specific explanation for the US and change in institution and policies that you have for the US and not for European countries. In Japan is close to Europe as well. So what are these specific policies? Usually the explanation, or one of the explanations that's given in the US for the rise of inequality is just globalization. So, you know, because of globalization, because of China entered the world labor market, you have a bigger supply of low-skill labor, and that's dragging down the low-skill wages in the US and in rich countries, and, you know, there's nothing we can do about it, that's just globalization. Now, you know, in the US, very often explanations tend to be a bit US-centered, but when you look at other countries, I think you have to come with a bit more complicated explanation, because globalization happened not only in the US, but also in Europe, in Japan, and you don't have the same rise of inequality. So you need something more than just globalization. And probably one part of the explanation is very high inequality of the social system in general in the US, and in particular inequality in access to education. So in the US, as we all know, you have very good top universities, but the bottom half of the population, not only they don't go to Harvard, but the kind of high school and community college they go to can be of pretty low quality and did not improve too much over the past three decades, whereas the resources invested in the skills at the top of the distribution have increased enormously. And probably this very high inequality in the supply of skill contributes to explain, you know, why the rise of inequality has been higher in the US. Now, there are other policies that are important, labor market policies, the fact that the minimum wage in the US did not increase too much, in fact, did not increase at all over this period. You know, the purchasing power of the federal minimum wage in the US right now is less than what it was in the late 1960s, which is quite unusual for a country over such a long period of time. So education policy, labor market policy, a big part also of what happened, you know, if you look at this very cyclical evolution at the end, this is because stock option and very top managerial compensation play a large role. So that's, you know, a very big part of this increase in the top 10% is in fact due to the top 1%, 0.5%, and I give the full decomposition in the book. Now, education is probably not the main explanation for that, because it's not that the top 0.5% is a lot more educated than the next 2 or 3% below them. So more investment in public universities in the US is probably a very important policy, but probably that's not going to change too much the relative income of the top 1% vis-a-vis the next 2 or 3%. So here it has probably more to do with the increased ability of top managers in a number of large corporations sometimes to set for themselves remuneration package that have, you know, that are very difficult, in fact, to justify on the basis of education or productivity or skills or performance, and that have more to do in some cases with their ability to put the right people in the right compensation committee in order to have the right increase in compensation. And I will argue at the end that the decline in very top tax rate in the US, which used to be extremely high until the 70s, much higher than in other developed countries, and which fell to very low level after the Reagan years, probably explain part of this increased incentives for top managers to try to get for themselves very high remuneration package. Anyway, so the general conclusion, when you look at the different evolution, you know, I've just given you these two examples of Europe and the US, but the general conclusion when you look at the evolution across different countries of income inequality is that there's a whole set of policies and institutions in the educational area, labor market, corporate governance, fiscal, which determine different trajectories in terms of inequality. So you can't say it's just it's globalization, because different policies can help different countries to make globalization work for broader social groups. So it ultimately depends on the policies and institutions. So let me now move to the analysis of wealth rather than income. So so when I talk in the book about wealth, I use wealth and capital in as synonymous, and this includes all assets that can be owned by private individuals or sometimes government. So this includes real estate assets, housing, but also business assets, professional assets, financial assets, minus all debt. Okay, so the wealth or capital concept that I use is always the net wealth, so what you own minus your debt. Okay, and so of course when you make this big addition of everything you own and you compute the total market value of what we own in a country or what particular people own, it's a big simplification of the fact that in practice, you know, capital is really a multidimensional notion. And one reason why the book is quite long is because I try to give justice to this multidimensional nature of capital, and I try to show that the history of real estate is different from the history of business assets, financial assets. I look at the importance of slavery, which is a very particular kind of asset before the abolition of slavery, the history of public debt. So all these different kind of assets give rise to different property relation between owners and workers, different social relations, different power struggle. You know, property relations are always very complicated relations, in particular international property relations, and Argentina as a country has a long experience with this, and I try in the book to look at these different kind of property relations and show how they must be analyzed one by one. Now, it is also useful for some purposes to make the big addition of the value of every assets that people own and look at the total value of wealth relative to income and to look at the total inequality of wealth. When we do that, here is what we find. So I'm first going to show you the basic fact about wealth as compared to income. So the first basic fact is that, as I already said, the inequality of wealth is always much higher than the inequality of income. So remember, for income, it's typically between one quarter and one half of total income going to the top 10. And the bottom half has typically maybe 20%, 25, sometimes a bit less than 20, and then the middle 40% has the rest, the people who are not in the bottom half and who are not in the top 10. Now, for the distribution of wealth, the concentration can be a lot more extreme, because the share going to the top 10 is always more than 50%, and sometimes as high as 90%, so almost everything. So let me show you the data. So this is the same graph as previously, except that now it's wealth inequality instead of income inequality. So you can see that the orders of magnitude are different. It's always more than 50%, and sometimes as 90%. What you should have in mind also is that whatever does not belong to the top 10 belongs to the middle 40%. The bottom half of the population never has any wealth, basically. So in every country and society for which we have data, the share of the bottom 50% in wealth is less than 5%. Okay, so whatever does not belong to the top 10 belongs to the bottom 40. So when you have a decline of the top 10, that's an increase in the share going to the middle 40, which is what I call the middle class in my book, the people who are not in the bottom half and society not in the top 10. And when you have an increase in the top 10% share in the recent decades, it means a decline of the middle class. Okay? So and the question is, how far will it go? So you know, for the bottom 50% in society, wealth is often a very abstract notion because you know, most people, you know, maybe they have 1 month in advance of income on their bank account, and this is all their wealth. And you know, some people have negative wealth if they only have debt. Or you know, for most people, wealth is very abstract. For society as a whole, as we are going to see on the next graph, total wealth on average can be 6 years of income on average. So you know, if average income is $30,000, average wealth will be $180,000. But for many people, the ratio between wealth and income is certainly not 6 years. You know, when you have only 1 month in advance on your bank account, your wealth-income ratio, the beta ratio in my book, is 1/12. You know, so it's much less than 6. So for many people, wealth is a very abstract notion. So it's very important when you look at wealth to distinguish how much the different groups own and what's the total aggregate value of wealth for society as a whole. So when you do that, so what you see is that first, you have this reversal between Europe and the US for wealth inequality in the same way as for income inequality. So Europe used to be more unequal a century ago, and is now less unequal. So this is also true for wealth. You know, Europe used to be more unequal than the US and is now less unequal. The difference is that the level of inequality of wealth today, even if they have increased, they are still much less than a century ago. A century ago, in every European society, there was basically no middle class, and this is everywhere, whether you look at France, Britain, and you know, that's important because in France, in my country, there was a lot of denial of inequality at that time. You know, a big part of the Republican elite in France in 1910 or 1914, they were always making comparison with Britain. You know, we like in Europe to compare each other and compare with Britain, compare with Germany, and the big discourse of the French elite in around 1914 was to say, we are a very equal country because we have made the French Revolution. So now we are a country of equal, and you know, we don't need to introduce progressive taxation. You know, progressive taxation, that's good for the British because they are an aristocratic society. But for us, the French, you know, with the French Revolution, that's enough. And indeed, you know, it's only the France, in fact, you know, France likes to present itself as the country of equality. But you know, this is a big joke. You know, there's a lot of hypocrisy in the French elite about this. And France was in fact the last European country to create the income tax in the summer of 1914, and this was not to pay for schools, this was to pay for the war. This was the only reason why the French Senate accepted to vote the creation of the income tax. So I think, you know, we have to be careful with the gap between the discourse about inequality and the reality. So when I look at the wealth data for France, what I found is that the concentration of wealth in 1913-1914 in France was just as extreme as in Britain, and you know, there's often a lot of hypocrisy of the elite about inequality, which study of history is a way to try to not to forget about this. So anyway, Europe was very unequal up to World War I. Then the concentration of wealth declined following the very big shocks of World War I, the Great Depression, World War II, and the US became gradually more unequal than Europe, partly because the shocks due to the war were less strong. Now, in recent decades, as I said, there's been a new rise of inequality, but the middle class today still has a bigger share of total wealth than a century ago. The question is, how is this going to change in the future? So in the rest of the presentation, you know, I will do a number of things, but in particular, I will try to distinguish between this evolution of inequality and the evolution of the total value of wealth relative to income. And so you can see that in terms of inequality, we are not back completely to the pre-World War I level, but in terms of wealth income ratio, you know, the total value of wealth, you can see that in Europe today we are back to very high wealth to income ratio. So in the 19th century and in the early 20th century, we had ratio between 6 and 7, which means that on average, you know, aggregate wealth was between six and seven years of income. So many people had very little, of course, and some people had a lot, but the total importance of wealth wealth in the 19th century was very large, not only in the novels of Balzac or Jane Austen, but also in the real economic data. And this corresponds to what I call in the book a patrimonial society with a very large importance of wealth and wealth transmission in particular. And we are going back to this very high wealth to income ratio, but with a level of inequality of wealth that is less extreme. So it means you have more middle class wealth. One of the questions is, will it last? So in the rest of this presentation, you know, I will show you more countries. You know, you can see that you have this big U-shape evolution for aggregate wealth in Germany, in France, in the United Kingdom. That's due to a large combination of factors: capital destruction during the war, but also the fact that a very big part of the private saving during this period between 1910 and 1950 was used not to invest and to accumulate new capital, but rather to pay for the war. So a big part of the private saving was used to purchase the public debt issued by the British government, the French government, the German government, and then the public debt was destroyed by inflation after 1945. So, you know, there was very little private wealth left in 1950. Also, the nationalization policy and rent control policy reduced the private value of wealth in 1950, 1960, and conversely, the financial deregulation and deregulation of rent control, etc., contributed to the return of high relative price of assets. There's also a real component of capital accumulation in this evolution. You know, all this effect, price effect, and accumulation effect play a role. In what follows, I will tell you a little bit more about the return, what I call the return of a patrimonial society. So I will talk mostly about the first two points. So I have already started to talk to you about the return of a patrimonial society, which you observe particularly in Europe and Japan, where wealth income ratios seem to be returning to very high levels in these low population growth countries. And here, an important intuition is that in Europe and Japan, we have very low population growth, you know, negative in some cases. In Japan or Germany or Italy are very close to negative population growth. And when you have very slow population growth or even negative, then wealth accumulated in the past can naturally become very important. Now, to the extent that population growth decline will happen everywhere, and you know, this can become an issue for Argentina and Latin American countries pretty fast, then this rise of wealth to income ratio can become relevant for the entire world. So this is partly a natural consequence of aging. The problem is that it comes sometimes with very high inequality of wealth within each cohort, and this raises new policy issues. The second point I will make is about the future of inequality of wealth or concentration of wealth, and, you know, will the middle class shrink in these countries or will it expand again? I will argue that one of the important determinants of wealth concentration in the long run is the gap between the net of tax rate of return, in particular for large wealth portfolios, because in the real world, not everybody gets the same rate of return, as we will see, and the growth rate of the economy. And to the extent that this gap will be higher in coming decades than it has been in the 20th century, this might lead to higher inequality level, maybe even higher than in the 19th century or closer to the 19th century. You know, of course, different institutions can allow to democratize wealth, to spread wealth, so this is only one possible evolution. So before I return to these two different points, let me say a bit more about you know, Argentina and Latin America. And let me again apologize, you know, for not being able to show you Latin America, you know, in this kind of graph where I have Europe, US. You know, I would like to show you Latin America, of course, and, you know, if the data was available, I would have used it, and I would be very happy to show it to you. So it's not that I don't want to talk about Latin America, it's just that the historical data was not there. Probably Latin America will be close to the highest level that we have, but the exact evolution, you know, we don't have the data. So Income inequality is known to be high in Argentina and across Latin America. Now, it is probably underestimated because the problem is that we usually, you know, the official estimates of inequality in Argentina or across Latin America usually rely on household survey. Now, the problem with household survey is that this relies on self-reported information on income and wealth, and this tends to underestimate inequality at the top. So fiscal estimates using fiscal data are probably more reliable, but still, you know, they should be viewed as lower bounds. And, you know, given tax evasions and there is substantial uncertainty and in some ways lack of transparency about national accounts and inflation numbers recently in a country like Argentina, you know, it's difficult to be really sure about the measures that we have. And in particular, you know, we were not able so far to access the individual level database on income tax return and wealth tax return in Argentina. You only have basic tabulations, and that's not sufficient to do, you know, to compute measures that are fully comparable to the other countries. So I will show you in a minute a graph on Argentina, but, you know, there is a lot of uncertainty about, in particular, on sort of the recent period. For wealth inequality, it is probably very high as well, but we do not really know because, you know, inheritance tax, as you know, was abolished in 1976 in Argentina. It has been reintroduced in 2011 in the Buenos Aires region, but you don't have it for the rest of the country, and you have this big gap between 1976-2011. And, you know, generally speaking, there's limited access to income, inheritance, and wealth tax data in Argentina. So, you know, my general conclusion is that for Argentina, like for other countries, we'll need more transparency about income and wealth, and that, you know, better access to data from progressive taxation of income, inheritance, and wealth could be a powerful way to produce information about how the different social groups are benefiting from growth. And also, in some cases, this could be a way to, I think, to fight corruption and also to analyze. In some cases, it will be a way to realize that maybe the income tax system in some countries, you know, I don't know in Argentina, but is not being applied as well as it should. So, you know, publishing the data at a local level with a very detailed breakdown by income brackets and wealth brackets can also be a way to improve the working of the tax system itself. So I think it's a wrong attitude to say, well, because there's tax evasion, we don't want to use the tax data. I think it's exactly the wrong attitude. I think it's by using it and that we can try to improve it and question it when it's not credible. And I think in a country like Argentina, that will be very useful. So let me show you what we have for now. I'm sorry that the colors are not really very readable, but so Argentina is in black and US is in red, so the two look like black, but in fact, the bottom one in the middle part is the US, and that's red. So according to this estimate, so these were estimates that we computed with Facundo Alvaredo on the basis of available data, which is very imperfect for Argentina. So according to this data, Argentina used to be more unequal than the US, and today is approximately the same level, or in fact, even a bit less unequal than the US for the recent period. Now, there are two big warnings. You know, first warning is that you have missing data between 1962 and 1996. So far, we were not able, you know, to access proper income tax data for this period. So that's a big gap, and the post-1996 data is not exactly comparable to the previous one. So, this creates a break in the survey. The other problem is that the estimates for 1997-2012, you know, are probably a lower bound. You know, there's probably more tax evasion in Argentina than in the US, and so we are trying now to make corrections, you know, using other data sources, in particular national accounts for self-employment income, and try to see what we can get, and, you know, when we get better access to data, we'll have better estimates. Let me show you other Latin American countries so that you can see that this can be very important. You know, look at, so this is Chile versus the US. So the bottom curve is Chile with a standard reported fiscal income excluding capital gains. The two middle curves that are supposed to be in red are the US, and the top curve is again Chile, but after you include retained profits and you adjust for the under-reporting of self-employment income using national accounts data. So doing this correction, and in particular using retained retained profits, so a big part, at least until the recent tax reform in Chile, a big part of the top incomes were keeping the income as retained earnings in companies, but if you put it back in personal income, you get levels of inequality in Chile which are extremely high, much higher than in the US. So this is still preliminary, and there, you know, we couldn't have access to the fiscal data before 2004. So this is a recent study by Fairfield and Jorat, which I think, you know, is still ongoing work, but this is suggesting that it's very important to use this kind of fiscal data. Let me give you finally another example, which is Brazil. So the bottom curve is the official inequality estimate for Brazil using survey data. The middle curve is the US using fiscal data, and the top curve is again Brazil using fiscal data. So you can see that moving from survey data to fiscal data makes Brazil substantially more unequal than the US, and probably the fiscal data is better. And probably the fiscal data is a lower bound because you have tax evasion. So the top incomes with the fiscal data are probably smaller than the true top incomes. So if you look not at the top 1% income share, but the top 10% income share, that's even clearer. And you can see that now it's not only that the level of inequality in Brazil becomes bigger than the US when you use the fiscal data, but it's also that the trend is different. So now instead of having a decline in inequality, you have an increase in inequality. So, you know, it's quite important to have access to the good data because this can change completely the perspective we have on the evolution of inequality. Now, the problem is that in many Latin American countries, we had access to fiscal data only very recently after the publication of my book. So I apologize that it's not in the book, but I, you know, I try to do what I can, and I'm showing you the data now that we have. And even today, we don't have the data before 2006 for Brazil. So I'm not able to show you the long run perspective, which is very important because inequality involves very long-run processes. So, you know, if you want to distinguish between the short-run effect due to the business cycle and the long-run historical evolution, you need more years. So, for Brazil, we have more years with survey data, and according to the official survey data estimate, you have a decline in inequality in Brazil over this period. But the problem is that when you use the fiscal data for the recent period, you have an increase. And we don't have the fiscal data before 2004. So, you know, in the end, I don't know. I mean, I'm not saying there was no decline at all in inequality in Brazil. You know, I think there are reasons to believe there was a decline, in particular because of the large increase in the minimum wage under Lula. But you know, we don't really know. So I think it's you know, it's sufficiently important, you know, to conclude that we need more transparency, better access to fiscal data in countries like Brazil or Argentina. So let me now come back to my 2 points about the return of a patrimonial society and the future of wealth inequality. And, you know, even though I cannot put Latin America for this analysis, I think there are lessons that can be drawn also for Latin America. So I have already shown you the long-run evolution of the capital income ratio for 3 countries. Now I am going to show you more countries, and I'm going to focus on the recent period. So I'm going to show you the next graph will be a zoom on the 1970-2010 period. I will show you more countries, and also I will show you annual series instead of decennial averages. So remember, with decennial averages, you can see everything looks very smooth. With annual series, the history of capital values is never smooth. It's always a very chaotic history because putting a price on capital is a very complicated business, and many people make a lot of money out of this business. And, you know, it's difficult to put a price on real estate assets, a price on stock market assets, and it's complicated. And so when you look at annual evolution of the market value of private capital relative to income, you get this kind of graph where you still have long-run evolution, but you also have lots of short-term fluctuation. So look at Japan. So this is the same ratio as on the previous graph, except that I focus on 1970-2010, and I have more countries. So these are the top 8 developed economies in the world. Let me stress that for this period, there was not too much archive or work, because this is, for the recent period, these are in fact official national accounts. So we now have, you know, people sometimes don't realize this, but national accounts now are about stock of assets and liabilities, about wealth, and not only about flows of output and GDP and saving and investment. So in all of these countries, we now have consistent national balance sheet in order to compute the total market value of private wealth relative to income. And some Latin American countries are now starting to compute this balance sheet, but we don't have for any Latin American countries a complete series for this period. But you know, soon in the future, we'll be able to, I hope, to do that kind of analysis, and that will be useful, because as you can see, you have a lot of action both in the short term and in the long term. You know, according to some economic textbook, the value, you know, the ratio of wealth to income or capital to output is supposed to be a constant. As you can see, this doesn't look too much like a constant, and so you know, you should be careful with economic textbook. You know, sometimes in economic textbook, when we don't know much about something, we just assume it's a constant, which you know, of course, if you have only one data point, everything is a constant. But as you can see, it's not at all a constant. In fact, there's no reason why it should be a constant. You know, even in the most orthodox neoclassical model of growth with capital labor substitution, any ratio of capital to output can be an equilibrium. You know, it all depends on how much you save and invest relative to how fast you grow in terms of productivity and population. And if you move to more unconventional model with multi-sector model, with speculation, the relative price of housing and the stock market that can vary a lot, then it's even more true. You can have, you know, lots of variation in the wealth to income ratio. In particular, if we try to explain why you have this increase, there is a number of explanations that are important. One factor, which I already mentioned, is the slowdown of population growth, so that's aging, you accumulate more wealth relative to income. Another factor is the rise of housing prices in the long run. So you can see the Japanese bubble with a very big increase in housing prices in the late 1980s, and then you have a decline. So that, you know, when you have such a big increase in such a short time in the wealth to income ratios, this cannot be just because of saving. You know, saving takes time. You know, the basic economic equation you need to have in mind is, if you save 10% per year of your national income and you want to build 5 years of capital, you need 50 years, 50 times 10% equals 5 years. So it's a very simple economic equation, but that's important. You know, complicated mathematics are not so useful in economics, but simple math can be useful. So saving takes time. So when you get rich so fast, you know, with your wealth income ratio going in Japan from 500 to 700% in just 4 years, this cannot be because of your saving. You know, even with a Japanese saving rate, you cannot accumulate wealth so fast. So that's because of a huge increase in the price of housing or the price of the stock market, which clearly was excessive, because then you have a decline. Now, if you look at other countries, you have a general increase in the price of housing and to some extent the stock market over the period, which can be explained by a mixture of reasons, you know, the decline of rent control policy, also the differential speed of technical change in the construction sector, transportation sector, relative to other sectors of the economy can generate big change in the long run in the relative price of housing relative to other goods. So once you enter the world of multi-sector model of capital accumulation, you know, anything can happen. You can have very big change in relative prices, and that's part of the explanation. Sometimes the bubbles can become even bigger than in Japan. So here, look at Spain. So, you know, here you have the increase of the wealth to income ratio in Spain until 2007, where you get to 800%, you know, at the end of the period for Spain, and now this is falling very fast. So, of course, bubbles are particularly dangerous when you have very high wealth to income ratio, because if you make a mistake in the price of your real estate in Spain by just 10%, if your ratio of wealth to income is 8 years of GDP, you know, this has a 10% mistake can have huge consequences for the real economy, much more than when you have a ratio of 200-300%, like in 1970. So the rise of wealth to income ratio is, you know, has important consequences for financial regulation, also for taxation, because, you know, when you have very high housing values and very high ratio of wealth to income at the end of the period, it means that for the new generation a new generation who want to accumulate wealth and who don't have family wealth, who only have their labor income, That's difficult. You know, this will have to be a very high labor income. So if you want to buy real estate in Madrid, Paris, or London just with your labor income these days, you know, that's much more difficult than in the 1970, where the ratio of the value of assets relative to income was much lower. So this has many consequences. Let me mention a third reason which has played a role for the increase in the wealth to income ratio, which is the decline of public wealth. And you know, this can be important for many countries, including in Argentina. So this is the comparison between private capital and public capital. And the sum of the two, by definition, is national capital. So what is public capital? Well, this is what the government and regional government, Social Security Administration own in assets. Buildings, financial assets, schools, hospitals, minus the debt. So again, these are the official national balance sheet. And what you find is that you have a general decline in public capital at the same time as you have a general increase in private capital. That's because, you know, you have privatization of public assets of the period, rise in household debt, rise in public debt. In some countries, like you see Italy at the end of the period in 2010, so this is the black square, you can see that Italy is at the very bottom for public capital and at the very top for private capital. And of course, the two are related. So why is it negative for public capital? You know, about minus 60-70% of national income. So this means that public debt in Italy right now is bigger than public assets. So even if the Italian government was to sell all the public buildings, all the public schools, all the public hospitals, public financial assets, this would not be enough to repay the public debt. Okay. So I'm not saying they should do this. You know, many people will be shocked if we had to pay rent to the owners of the schools to which we send our children. But in a way, this is already what we are doing, because when you have public debt that's bigger than the value of the public assets, in effect, you end up paying interest on your public debt that can be higher than the rent that you will pay on you know, the public assets if they were owned by private individuals. So in the case of Italy, right now, they pay each year about 6% of GDP in interest payment. To themselves, you know, to their own rentiers or to other, you know, European households that own the public debt directly or indirectly, whereas the total budget of the entire university system in Italy is about 1% of GDP. Okay, so you put six times more resources to repay interest payments than you invest in universities, which probably is not the best way to prepare the future. Okay, so when you have you know, very low public wealth, zero or even negative public wealth, you know, this limits the ability of the government to play its role and invest in public infrastructure, invest in the future, and I think this is a matter of concern. In other countries like the US or Germany or Britain or France, this is public capital is not negative, it is slightly positive, because according to official estimates, the value of public assets is a bit above 100% of GDP and maybe 120-130, and the public debt is 80-90% of GDP, so the difference between the two is slightly positive, but it's very small. In 1970, there was no public debt, or very little public debt, largely because the public debt, including in countries like Germany and France, had gone through some big restructuring in the 1950s, so the public debt coming from the war was brought down to zero, which was probably a very good choice in order to be able to invest in reconstruction, invest in growth, and there was substantial public asset in the 50s, 60s, and until the 70s, so that public capital was typically around up to one year of national income in the 1970s, at a time when private wealth was between 2 and 3 years of national income. So in other words, the share of public capital in national capital was between 1/4 and 1/3. Okay, so the government would own between 1/4 and 1/3 of everything that was to own. Whereas today, it's less than 5% everywhere, and usually, and sometimes negative. Okay. So the share of government in total national capital is something that's important to look at. You know, of course, public capital is always less than private capital in these countries. This does just mean that these countries have never been communist countries, which you know we all know. But it's always good to check, you know, to be sure that we have done nothing wrong. It's very different when you have one quarter and one third of property in public hands, or zero or negative. Okay, so this is a big evolution over this time period. And there are countries where, of course, this evolution has been even more extreme. You know, if I was to put Russia in this graph, you know, you will go from 100% of public capital to 0% of public capital and everything in private capital. And of course, the Russian oligarchs did not become rich by saving. They became rich by direct transfer of public wealth to private wealth. And typically, they acquired large part of natural resources at very low price. And so this is like a pure transfer from public to private wealth. And that's an important part of the evolution of wealth over this period. So let me finally look at the evolution of inequality of wealth, and in particular the very top wealth segment of the distribution, which includes Russian oligarchs, but also all sorts of different people from different countries. And one of the striking evolution, so here I am showing you a table using data from Forbes magazine of billionaire, showing that top wealth holders in the world seem to be rising a lot faster than average wealth in the world. Let me make very clear that I don't view this data as particularly reliable. And you know, in a way, it is sad that we have to read magazines to learn about wealth these days. You know, I would prefer to read IMF publication and Eurostat publication, but unfortunately, you won't find the information. Partly because during many years, the IMF and rich countries' government opposed the kind of financial transparency and automatic transmission of bank information about cross-border financial assets that you will need in order to be able to produce reliable public information about the distribution of wealth. You know, the kind of household survey on wealth or even fiscal data on wealth that we have for the very recent period is very poor. In particular, it's a very poor way to measure cross-border financial assets. So we have to do with what we have. So you know, this is not perfect. And you know, one of the reasons why I tend to like progressive wealth tax and cooperation, international cooperation with progressive wealth tax is this would be a way to produce better data on wealth and to adjust our policy to whatever we observe. But for the time being, we have to do with what we have. So here is what we have. We have here, you know, I started in 1987 because this is when Forbes magazine started to publish their global ranking of billionaires. So each year they publish the list of everybody in the world that has more than $1 billion, according to them. You know, their method is not always entirely clear, but you know, they do what they can. So what if you take this data and you you look at top groups at the representing a fixed fraction of the world population at the top, and you look at the speed at which the average wealth of this group has been rising, you find that they've been rising at 6 to 7% per year in real terms after deduction of inflation. This is 3 to 4 times faster than the growth rate for average world wealth per adult. Average world income per adult has increased at 1.4%, so this is less fast than average world wealth. This is because of the rise in the wealth-to-income ratio, so average wealth is rising somewhat faster than average income. Note that world GDP growth over this period has been 3.3%, largely due to emerging countries, but 1.9% of this world GDP growth was taken in a way by world adult population growth. Okay, so population growth is supposed to go to zero, but it's not there yet. Okay, it's still quite high, particularly due to aging. Over this period, you know, a big part of the feeling of growth that we have in the world today is still due to population growth. Okay, but if you deduct population growth, in fact, per adult average income growth has been only 1.4% over this period. And this is still about the same right now. In 2015, world growth will be about 3%, 3.2%, and half of it is population growth. So sometimes we forget about population growth, but you know, it will go to zero at some point, according to the United Nations, but we are not there yet. So in the end, the average income has increased at 1.4, average wealth 2.1. So the top seems to be rising 3-4 times faster than the average. So of course, this cannot continue forever, because if this was to continue forever, the share of world wealth going to billionaires will go to 100%, which everybody would agree is too much. So, and I'm not saying this will go to 100%. You know, I'm sure this will stop before that. Now, where will it stop exactly? You know, nobody knows. What is sure is that we are in a situation where the share going to the top is rising very fast, not only within rich countries, but also at the world level. So in spite of the convergence between the middle of the world distribution and the bottom, the inequality at the top at the world level it seems to be rising very fast. There is nothing natural in there. You know, in particular, the fact that you have new entrepreneurs, new wealth, in itself is not an explanation for this, because of course you have mobility, you have new wealth. You know, the people at the top in 1987 are not the same as the people at the top at 2013. So in 1987, according to Forbes, the people at the top are billionaires from Japan, which everybody has forgotten their name today. And in 2013, you have people from the US, people from China, from Europe, you have people from Latin America, like Carlos Slim in Mexico, and I'm sure there are some in Argentina, or Brazil, or all over the place. And, you know, that's fine, you have mobility. But the fact that there is new wealth is not an explanation for this very big rise at the top, because, you know, you have mobility, you have some people going down, some people going up. But in principle, if we were in an equilibrium of the world distribution of wealth, these two effects should more or less compensate each other, so that the average growth rate at the top, taking into account people going down, people going up, should be approximately the same as the average growth rate for the entire distribution. Now, you cannot have, it's okay in society to have some rich people, some middle people, some poor people, but you need the different groups to grow more or less at the same speed in the long run. Now, you cannot have some groups that grow 3-4 times faster. And I think everybody, you know, including and particularly people who want to defend, you know, entrepreneurship and private wealth accumulation, should take this seriously, because this is very serious. You know, you cannot have the top of the wealth distribution rise 3-4 times faster forever than the average. So what is the explanation for this? Part of it could be that over this time period, as I mentioned, there's been a lot of privatization, so there's a lot of new private wealth to own, and indeed a big part of the new fortunes are sometimes related to privatization, not only in ex-communist countries, but also, you know, in Mexico, Carlos Slim got very good deals with privatization of telecom. You know, this is part of the process that has been important over this time period. Another, and maybe this will not continue because there is not much left to privatize, so you know, the good news is that this will have to stop. Now, another explanation, which I think played a role, is that financial deregulation seems to have increased inequality in financial returns. So when I talk about R versus G, the rate of return versus the growth rate, it's important to keep in mind that the rate of return is not the same for everyone. Okay, so and probably the inequality in financial returns, depending on whether you have a very large portfolio or a very small portfolio, has probably increased because of financial deregulation. And evidence for this comes from this table, where you have returns to the capital endowments of US universities between 1980 and 2010. The only reason why I'm showing you this data is not so much to talk about university, although this is a very interesting question, but that's not really the purpose. The only reason I'm showing this to you is because at least we have good data about what they do with their wealth. You know, they publish financial statements, so we know how they allocate their endowment, why they get such high returns, which, you know, we don't have such data for the Forbes people. So you can see that they are doing very well. You know, between 1980 and 2010, the average return on university endowments has been 8.2% after deduction of inflation, after deduction of all management fees, administrative costs. So clearly, they are not putting their money in U.S. Treasury bonds. You know, there are people in the world who put their money in U.S. Treasury bonds. I don't know why, but I can tell you that U.S. universities have not done that for a very, very long time. Okay? So they put their money in complex financial derivatives, commodity derivatives, private equity, and they have people to do that. They pay people to do that. Now, Harvard, for instance, you know, right now pays about 0.3% each year of their endowment to pay a group of wealth managers. But because they have an endowment of $40 billion, you know, 0.3% of $40 billion is more than $100 million, which is a good sum of money to pay wealth managers. You can, you know, even if these people are costly, you can pay a good group of wealth managers with $100 million each year. And if that's enough to get you a return of 10 rather than 6, that's worth it. Now, if you have $100 million in endowment, which is already quite good, you know, I can tell you the Paris School of Economics doesn't have $100 million. But if you have $100 million, of course, you cannot spend $100 million each year in wealth managers. Okay? And if you have $10,000 or pesos, you know, you can ask your brother-in-law for some advice about your investment strategy, but probably that's not going to work too well, on average. Sometimes it works well. But. So anyway, you know, if that's probably a powerful reason for, you know, for rising inequality. So again, according to the textbook model of capital market, this should not happen. You know, according to the textbook model, when you have more financial market sophistication, more financial innovation, this should allow everybody to get the same return and the best return on the planet. So, you know, the textbook model is you go to your bank with $10,000 and, you know, the next morning it gets invested in China in the highest possible return on the planet, and that's fine. The real world doesn't seem to work too much like this. And, you know, financial deregulation seems to have led in some cases to a situation where, you know, some people are able to get very sophisticated financial assets which deliver high returns, and some people are being sold pretty lousy investment and returns. So that can be a powerful force leading to rising inequality. Let me also mention, you know, it's interesting to compare these financial returns with the amount that goes into private philanthropy in U.S. universities. That's important because we live at a time where we sometimes hear some completely, you know, crazy and overly optimistic discourse about private philanthropy. You know, sometimes you hear that, you know, you don't need taxation anymore. We just need to wait for billionaires to give some of their wealth in health and education, and taxation is backward, and, you know, it's just private philanthropy is going to solve everything. I have nothing against private philanthropy. Again, I have contributed to the creation of the Paris School of Economics, which is a private foundation which has private donors. But, you know, I think this must come on the top of taxation, not instead of taxation. So in the case of US universities, we have the data on how much you get through private philanthropy, and here are the numbers. So for Harvard, over this time period, the total gift made to Harvard each year represent about 0.5% annually of the endowment. So as compared to the 10% real rate of returns, it's completely negligible. This just does not matter at all. Okay? So this can be useful sometimes to get your children admitted into Harvard, so that's very useful. But in terms of a total return, you know, if you want to understand why the endowment of Harvard has gone from $3 billion 20 years ago to 40 today, all what matters is the financial rate of return. So I think, you know, it's important on these things to look at the numbers, because otherwise you hear very strange things. Let me conclude by talking a little bit about taxation and policy, and you know, this will be the end. This graph about top income tax rate, and the final one about top inheritance tax rate, and will be done. So, you know, what is the solution to inequality? So, as you know, I tried to make clear that it's you know, there's not one magic solution. You know, it's a combination of policies and institutions, education, labor market, fiscal policy. So, of course, progressive taxation can be particularly useful, and is, in a way, this is the most transparent way to try to control the dynamics of wealth inequality. So, when you have, so I'm going to return to this graph in a minute, but it's clear that when you have this kind of evolution where very top wealth groups rise 3 to 4 times faster than the average, you know, this gives you a sense of the kind of tax rate on wealth that you would need for high wealth group in order to keep the distribution distribution stable in the long run, if this is the objective, or to avoid, you know, whatever your target is in terms of inequalities, this gives you a sense of what kind of tax progressivity you will need. And this can require pretty high tax rate on high wealth. Now, of course, if we have data showing us a different conclusion, you know, if in fact the top wealth group don't grow at 6-7% per year, but grow only at 1 or 2% per year, like average wealth, then I will be happy to say that we don't need very progressive taxation of wealth. So, you know, it's not that I know what should be the tax rate. I think what we need is more transparency about income and wealth, ideally, so that we can adjust our tax rate to whatever happens. Now, will this happen? Well, you know, as I've started to show you, the history of taxation is full of surprise, and you know, you cannot always anticipate what will happen. So if you look, so this is a short summary of the history of income taxation in 4 countries. So you can see that 1 century ago, the income tax did not exist, or existed with very low tax rate, and many people were saying it will never exist. You know, in the US, there was a constitution made it impossible to exist, so it was a very strong reason. And then finally, it existed, and you know, the income tax was created, and it became very high. So these are the top income tax rates. So let me make very clear, you know, sometimes we forget about this long history. Sometimes we imagine, we look only at the recent period, and in particular, we imagine that the US has started to exist only after Reagan, but the US existed before Reagan, and it's important to be aware of that. And you know, there is a long and complicated history of the US with inequality and taxation. You know, this is not just the simple history that we sometimes have in mind. So let me make clear that when you have top income tax rate of 80 or 90% in the US and in the UK, you know, this applied only to very, very high incomes. Okay, so these are the top income tax rates. So of course, this did not apply to everybody. Typically, this applied to less than 1% of the population. In the US, to be more specific, you know, if you look between 1930 and 1980, you have on average a top income tax rate of 82%. Sometimes it's 91 under Roosevelt. Sometimes it's 70%, like in the 70s. On average, it's 82, if you make the simple average over this 50-year-long period. So that's a pretty long period. This applied to very high incomes, typically above $1 million in annual income, in today's income. And probably this is the reason why, you know, this clearly did not destroy US capitalism and, you know, productivity growth, if anything, was higher in the 50s, 60s, 70s in the US than it has been since Reagan. And probably the explanation is that it's not so useful to pay managers $10 million rather than $1 million. You know, of course, you need to pay managers well, you need some level of inequality, but you know, when you pay people in the financial sector or even in large non-financial corporations several million dollars, it's not clear at all that you get anything useful for growth or, you know, economic activity, or, you know, at least I could not find it in the data that I used. So, you know, we have this complicated history of taxation, and probably the future will also be very complicated. You know, there's been a complete change in attitude towards inequality in taxation in the 70s, particularly in Britain and the US, but there will be other changes in the future. And I think it's important to have this complicated history in mind in order to prepare ourselves for changes that will happen in the future. You know, the future will be different from this. You know, it will involve different political conflict, power struggle, which will lead to different policy innovation, fiscal and social compromise, and you know, there's no way I can predict what will happen. But you know, I think it's important to have in mind this common history, because you know, this is not so far, you know, and you have this evolution for income taxation. Let's look at the similar picture for inheritance taxation. You can see, so these are, again, these are the top tax rates. So these are the top tax rate applying to the largest inheritance. So you can see, again, the US and the UK have gone very far, 70-80%, as compared to France and Germany. Probably this is because France and Germany, a lot of the redistribution of wealth in the 20th century was done by inflation, debt restructuring, destruction, capital destruction. It was a very important form of wealth redistribution, whereas in the US and the UK, progressive taxation was used a lot more intensively. It's quite interesting to see that the only time, look at Germany in 1946, 1948, you know, this is the only time where you have very high tax rate, and it is the same for income taxation. You see Germany in 1946, 1948, they have a 90% tax rate. This is when the tax policy of Germany was set by the Americans. This was the Allied Control Council that was setting the tax policy of Germany. And it was the same in Japan. This was the only time where you have 90%. And when Germany takes its sovereignty back in 1949, they reduce the top tax rate very fast and they go down to 50% in the 1950s because they don't want to keep this crazy American level of 90% top tax rate. Now, what's interesting is that the Americans, they were not doing this. They were not doing this to punish the Germans or the Japanese, because they were doing the same thing at home at that time. So, you know, to them, this was certainly not a punishment. This was part of what they viewed at the time as the civilization package that they were bringing to Germany and Japan. You bring democratic institution, and at the same time, you bring fiscal institution in order to prevent democracy from becoming a plutocracy with excessive concentration of income and wealth at the top. So I know this can seem very exotic to some of you and very ancient history, but you know, this is not so old, and this is clear illustration that the history of inequality and taxation involves not only economic forces, but complex political, cultural, social forces, and it will be the same in the future. There are different ways to organize capitalism. You can organize capitalism with inheritance tax, and you know, I don't know what will happen in Argentina in the future. Will Argentina reintroduce an inheritance tax? So right now it's 0% at the national level in Argentina. In Brazil it's more, it's 4%, but it's still pretty small, with indirect tax on consumption, which are sometimes 20-30%, but you know, an inheritance is 4% or 0% in Argentina. So how will this change in the future? You know, nobody knows. But in any case, I think, you know, it is useful to have this broad international and historical perspective on these issues in order to be better informed about our future democratic discussion and fight. So let me stop there, and thanks a lot for your attention.
Como dije, yo voy a abrir un poco el debate planteando algunos temas que me parecen importantes cuando uno lee el libro en América Latina. Entonces, es un libro que yo empecé siendo profesor de Historia del Pensamiento Económico, mis primeros pasos como economista, y leía mucho a los clásicos. Es un libro que cuando uno lo lee, recuerda el pensamiento clásico, por dos cuestiones fundamentales: por la inclusión de la política, de la economía política, en la visión del economista, y por la cuestión del foco en la distribución. La economía actual tiene un foco un poco más puesto en la cuestión de la asignación de recursos, en la eficiencia. Los economistas clásicos lo tenían eso, pero además de eso tenían la cuestión distributiva. Entonces este libro me pareció muy refrescante por esa cuestión. En segundo lugar, es un libro donde la democracia y la política juegan un rol fundamental. La democracia está siempre al lado de la desigualdad, porque la desigualdad es vista como un problema, como un peligro para la democracia. Incluso si Kuznets estuviera en lo correcto y en el muy largo plazo el ingreso se hiciera más igualitario y la distribución de la riqueza, igual la democracia podría estar en peligro en el camino si se generan problemas distributivos muy grandes. Esto me lleva a decir una cuestión fundamental, es que cuando uno lee el trabajo, lo primero que lo impacta es el trabajo con los datos. Tenemos mucha teoría a veces en economía y nos faltan datos. Y por suerte hoy hay una corriente muy importante de darle importancia a los datos. Esta es una, la cuestión de la riqueza y la desigualdad. Otra muy importante que es también fundamental para el trabajo, pero que viene de otra línea, que es la de la demografía. Hay mucho dato nuevo de demografía que antes no teníamos y cosas que ahora sabemos porque tenemos los datos. Y hay datos también con lo que se llama la economía verde. Las cuentas nacionales están empezando a ser, ¿cierto?, con datos mucho más importantes que antes. Hay un esfuerzo enorme. Entonces es muy bienvenido, ¿cierto?, este esfuerzo que ha hecho Piketty. Y creo que tiene una lección, y es que muchas veces los economistas se quejan porque hay mucha deficiencia y poco de equidad en la economía. Pero la diferencia de él es que se puso a trabajar. Porque si uno quiere tener el foco en la desigualdad, tiene que trabajar mucho. Y él ha estado haciendo un excelente trabajo, como se pudo ver en la presentación. Por último, ahora quisiera cerrar mis breves comentarios con una visión sesgada, y subrayo sesgada, del libro leído desde América Latina. Y cómo cambia la visión sobre la distribución, las cuestiones de riqueza, cuando uno lee este libro en la Argentina, o en Chile, o en Brasil. Yo soy un economista especializado en América Latina, y bueno, aunque no lo quiera, lo leo con esa perspectiva. Por eso voy a hacer tres comentarios que no pretenden reducir el libro a lo que yo voy a decir, sino más bien cómo este libro nos sirve para hacer economía y para reflexionar sobre nuestros problemas. Y justamente una de las cuestiones que enfatiza mucho el libro, él llega a decir que es un libro tanto de economía como de historia. Y es algo que a veces se pierde, la dimensión histórica, el contexto de lo que uno dice. Entonces, cuando uno lee este libro con el contexto latinoamericano, hay tres cuestiones estructurales que son fundamentales para entender estos problemas. Primera cuestión fundamental, son economías duales, economías donde hay un sector informal enorme. Sí, y Argentina no es el peor en América Latina, pero seguro un tercio de la población está fuera de lo que se llama la fiscalidad, en cierto sentido. Está fuera de las políticas públicas, en cierto sentido, y está fuera de las taxes, los impuestos. Cuando uno mira estas economías, aparece otro problema, que es el de la pobreza. Entonces es verdad que tenemos que mirar lo que pasa con con el decil más rico, o con el 1% más rico, con el 0,1% más rico, pero igual tenemos un tercio de pobres que están excluidos y tenemos que tener políticas para ellos. Esto es muy importante porque otro mensaje del libro que es fundamental es que sin datos no se puede. Y no solamente no se puede ser buen economista, no se puede ser un buen demócrata sin datos confiables. Y eso es fundamental, es una tarea fundamental del Estado y la política generar los datos, que no existen, como en el caso del el 1% más rico. Ellos han hecho un esfuerzo por mostrarnos todo lo que podríamos decir, pero también a veces ocurre que tecnologías muy comprendidas y sabidas no se utilizan, ¿cierto? Por ejemplo, para saber cuántos pobres hay y por qué son pobres. Entonces, esta es la primera cuestión. El segundo rasgo estructural, junto con este rasgo de dualidad, es que la demografía de América Latina es muy distinta a la demografía de los países desarrollados. Los países desarrollados ya están entrando en la etapa de aging, en la etapa de envejecimiento. Nosotros todavía estamos en la etapa del bono demográfico. Y algunos países, como Bolivia, todavía están previo a ese periodo. Y en general todos los países pobres de América Latina, los más pobres, son los más jóvenes. Entonces, cuando uno mira eso, ve que los europeos, los japoneses, los Estados Unidos hasta cierto punto, son viejos, pero ya son ricos. Y América Latina, y en particular nuestro país, corre el riesgo de hacerse viejo sin hacerse rico. Y si uno a eso le suma lo que yo cuando leí el libro, yo trabajé bastante en demografía últimamente, Cuando leí el libro, me daba un poco de fastidio que no se me hubiese ocurrido a mí mirar tanto las herencias. Porque yo miré mucho la cuestión del bono demográfico y el envejecimiento. Pero ¿qué ocurre si somos pobres, viejos y con la riqueza hiperconcentrada en algunos herederos? Es un escenario feo. Y en los trabajos que yo he realizado junto con otros investigadores de China, de Sudáfrica, de la India, lo que hemos visto es que cuando uno mira la transición demográfica, las transiciones demográficas son muy rápidas, mucho más rápidas que la francesa o la alemana. Y al mismo periodo de la transición demográfica, los franceses o los alemanes eran mucho más ricos que nosotros. Entonces ahí hay una segunda cuestión que nos abre los ojos. Así que estamos haciendo con nuestro bono demográfico. Y el último punto estructural de América Latina, que tiene que ver con la riqueza y los activos, es que nosotros, si vamos a ser ricos, el activo más fuerte que tenemos, sobre todo en América del Sur, son los recursos naturales. Hemos tenido la mejor década de América Latina en términos del intercambio. No somos más ricos que antes, no somos mucho más ricos que antes. Él nos mostraba los gráficos de cómo subió la relación entre el capital y el ingreso. Si yo les muestro a América Latina, no subió. Nuestro problema es que nuestra relación capital-producto todavía sigue siendo baja. Y si la queremos aumentar, tenemos que seguir la famosa regla de que uno no debe consumirse los recursos naturales, ¿cierto? La famosa regla de Hartwig, que dice que si uno se consume los recursos naturales y no ahorra, va a ser pobre. Entonces, ¿por qué digo esto? Porque es verdad que tenemos muchos ricos, pero también es verdad que tenemos mucho Estado. En Venezuela los recursos naturales no son del sector privado, son del sector público. En Chile, buena parte de los recursos naturales son del sector público, no del sector privado. En la Argentina, buena parte de los impuestos que se cobran sobre el recurso natural tierra, vía retención de las exportaciones. Entonces, así como es importante mirar lo que hacen los ricos con la plata, es muy importante, hay que mirar lo que hace el Estado con la plata. No en vano, en la teoría económica se habla de la maldición de los recursos naturales. Los países que utilizan mal los recursos naturales, justamente porque tenemos capitalismos que son capitalismos prebendarios, capitalismos de amigos. Entonces, bienvenida a la economía. En América Latina yo creo que es más fácil ser Piketty que en Estados Unidos, porque nosotros tenemos una gran tradición, cierto que nos viene de Prebisch y otra gente, tenemos una gran tradición de mirar la distribución del ingreso, y por eso es bienvenido y refrescante tener aquí a Piketty y tener su libro para leerlo si todavía no lo hicieron. Muchas gracias. La primera pregunta, creo que yo lo estuve escuchando, le va a gustar contestarla, es, se ha hablado de desigualdad en el interior de cada nación a nivel internacional. ¿Se reduce o se amplía la desigualdad? ¿Considera que hay relación entre la desigualdad mundial y las amenazas a la paz, guerras, terrorismo, etcétera? Did you understand? Sí. Great.
So, I'm sure one by one. Or...
Respondo una a una.
Well, I'll try to, you know.
Okay. So, international inequality. So, first, does it increase? Is it declining? There are contradictory forces going on. You know, there is a convergence process between emerging countries and richer countries, or at least between part of emerging countries and richer countries, so that this tends to lead to a reduction of inequality at the international level. At the same time, you know, I think international inequality can, you know, is still extremely high and can take, in particular, international wealth inequality and international property property relations, you know, can take very violent and extreme forms. And in my, so in my book, you know, I try to compare, for instance, you know, the level of international wealth inequality, and in particular, the size of foreign assets. At the time of the colonial empire, you know, at the beginning of the 20th century, in the interwar period, with the new forms of foreign assets that you have today, and you know, I think we can have again a sort of this kind of very large imbalance and very large inequality, which can lead to very violent conflict. You know, property relations are always complicated. You know, paying rent to your owner is always a complicated affair, but it's when it's you pay rent to another country, when you are being owned partly by another country, it's even more complicated, and it is usually this very often leads to very violent form of regulation. At, you know, at the time of the colonial empires, which I study in my book, of course, this came with military domination. And so I try to put this in perspective and to warn against the possible return of very large foreign asset position, which we already have, of course, in some cases. But at this stage, we, of course, don't have as large foreign asset position as we had at the time of when, in effect, Britain and France were the owner of very big part of the rest of the world and were receiving in capital income from the rest of the world huge flows which are very hard to imagine today. You know, this was sufficient to, in effect, you know, France and Britain until World War I were in a situation of permanent trade deficit and still could keep buying the rest of the world because the capital income coming from the rest of the world was much, much bigger than their trade deficit. So, you know, it's as if you pay, you're paying rent to the owner of your apartment, and with the rent, the owner is buying the rest of the building. So, you know, except that it takes place at the international level, so that can be, you know, this kind of international inequality, I think, is can be very extreme. Connection with war and terrorism, you know, it's very complicated, but certainly, you know, extreme inequality when we don't find a peaceful solution and democratic solution, often gives rise to you know, nationalist solution, ethnic division, and so, you know, at some level there is certainly a link.
Thanks. Something related with this, and it is in English. So, what kind of new type of economic and social elite could you expect to see if the current trend towards patrimonial capitalism continues?
Well, I think it will be, you know, a combination of patrimonial elite and managerial elite, and it will, you know, it will combine different aspects. So it will not be exactly like the, you know, the 19th century patrimonial elite with large inheritance. It will be in some ways it can be even worse because it can combine, you know, very large inequality of wealth with very large inequality of labor earnings, and also a very strong stigmatizing discourse against people with lower income or with middle income. So, you know, at least in the old sort of patrimonial societies, you know, nobody was trying to, you know, in Jane Austen novel, nobody is trying to blame the servants or the people who don't have wealth for their lack of merit. You know, they just happen to be poor, they were born with no wealth, and the wealthy were born with wealth, and maybe this was justified by the idea that this would allow a small group to do something else in life than to care about survival and to do scientific activity, artistic activities. Well, you know, I'm not saying this were good justification, but at least the discourse was not putting too much pressure on the losers in terms of merit. Whereas modern inequality, and I think the modern elite, you know, they like to at the same time to combine, you know, very extreme concentration of wealth and partly inherited wealth with you know, a very strong moralizing discourse and meritocratic discourse, sort of blaming the poor or the middle for their lack of merit or lack of productivity. And then, so in a way, you know, modern inequality is putting even more pressure than the traditional inequality, and you know, that's, so you can have this kind of combination, I think, in the future.
So I have another one in English. The top 10% of the population is becoming increasingly rich, but how likely or easy is to access to this top 10% or fall from this group? Is there more or less mobility across classes?
Well, there's no evidence for more mobility. And, you know, if anything, you know, given the return of large inheritance, in some dimensions, there's a decline of mobility. For instance, you know, in terms of access to wealth, it is certainly for the young generation, you know, as I mentioned during my talk, if you want to accumulate wealth without any family wealth, given the very high housing prices today, that's very difficult. So, you know, you have less mobility for the generation born in the 70s, 80s in terms of access to wealth and for the generation of their parents. Now, if we take the mobility of labor earnings, you know, some people in the US claim that, you know, we don't really care about the increase in inequality because at the same time there was an increase in mobility, except that there is no data showing this. And in fact, the best studies we have looking at the evolution of mobility suggest that maybe it has been stable, maybe it has declined a little bit, but certainly it has not increased. So this cannot possibly be a justification for increasing inequality.
Okay. I'm trying my best. Porque tenemos que terminar 8:15, así que tenemos una pila enorme de preguntas y no quiero que nadie se sienta ofendido. Estoy tratando de poner varias preguntas juntas, pero estas tres son muy interesantes para mí también como economista. ¿Cuál fue la inquietud académica y personal que dio origen a esta investigación? ¿Cómo explica el fenómeno provocado por su libro en términos académicos, siendo que la academia no discute libros, sino papers populares, siendo que no parece un libro amigable al público general y político, siendo que el discurso que domina es de derecha? Y
well, you know, I don't know. You know, maybe I was just very lucky with this book. And, you know, I think the success of the book, to me, reflects the fact that there's a very strong demand for some form of democratization of economic knowledge. You know, I think there are many people in many countries who are tired to hear that this is too complicated for them, that economics is so complicated that only a small group of experts and economists can understand this sophisticated science that economists have built. And, you know, of course, this is a big joke, and many people are tired to hear this joke. And I think the success of the book comes from the fact that I think it's a very accessible book. You know, it's a bit too long, and I am sorry about this, but it's really readable and accessible by anybody. You know, it's not a technical book, and so, you know, what makes me really happy with the success of the book is when I meet people who tell me that, you know, of course they are not economists, that usually don't read that kind of big books, and they have understood everything. Now, as you mentioned, you know, economists very often don't read books anymore. Well, they don't write books anymore, and sometimes they don't read books anymore either. They are very focused on short articles. You know, I also write short academic articles. I think that can be sometimes useful discipline to write things in this short format. But I think it's also important to write books because there are big historical issues like this which you can only address in books. My personal interest for this issue and for this approach, you know, in a way, You know, I don't know. I live, you know, in a generation, and my family. You know, I was very interested in political issues, historical issues. You know, I was born in 1971, so I became an adult with the fall of the Berlin Wall, and then in 1989, and in 1991, I was very much impressed by the way, Western country suddenly sent 1 million troops in Iraq to give back the oil to the Emir of Kuwait. So this historical events, you know, I guess the issue of inequality under capitalism, I was very much interested. Then I realized that there was a lot of historical data that had never been collected. So it was a bit by coincidence. You know, I was first hired as a young assistant professor at MIT doing theory, you know, proving theorems, and then I realized that there was all this historical data that could be collected, and you know, I didn't want to spend my life proving theorems, and I thought that I would start to collect this historical data. I returned to France partly because I wanted to be closer to this tradition of research in the social sciences, in history, in sociology, looking at the history of wages and social groups and social class, and I felt that by staying in an economic department in the US, probably I would not have done that. So, you know, I was interested in history and politics more than in economics, in a way. And so I started looking at working on the history of income and wealth because this was a natural way to get closer to what I was really interested in.
¿Qué crítica?
¿Qué se hizo?
What?
¿Qué crítica?
What review of the book would you adopt for the future? Would you incorporate to your book? What comments would you?
So many interesting comments everywhere. You know, especially, you know, looking, going to very different countries to talk about the book always, you know, gives me new ideas and new, and you know, just to take an example, you know, I think what you've said about natural resources in Latin America is very important. And clearly in my book, I don't talk enough about natural resources. That certainly, and all the entire issue of sustainable development and renewable resources, you know, I talk about it in the last chapter of the book, but this is too little. And the way I talk about oil a little bit, but as you can see, I was more influenced by the Middle East and the war on Iraq. So when I talk about oil and natural resources, I talk a lot about sovereign wealth funds and you know, United Arab Emirates, etc. But of course, in Latin America, the issue of natural resources is very different because it's not, you know, when I talk about natural resources, I only talk about countries with very little population, so we are just accumulating these huge sovereign wealth funds. In Latin America, the issue is very different. The issue is, are we going to spend it? Are we going to invest in other forms of capital? And so these are issues which I don't talk about in my book, and they are clearly extremely important. You know, I probably don't talk enough about trade unions. You know, I talk about trade unions a little bit, wage bargaining, minimum wages in you know, some chapters of the book, but this is too little. So, yeah, it's, you know, next time I will write a bigger book. You know, it's too small. Huh?
Yeah. Okay. For me, this length was okay. ¿Qué experiencia? Sorry. ¿Qué experiencias existen en el mundo en cuanto a cooperación para reducir las desigualdades? ¿Y qué rol juegan los paraísos fiscales en este nuevo capitalismo?
You know, tax havens are, you know, it's very difficult to find them, but I think it's possible to make progress. You know, I think in the end, these are small territories, so if we take the right sanctions, you know, including trade sanctions if necessary, it's not so difficult, you know, but we need to have more international cooperation. You know, the problem is that very often, you know, we have a huge gap between what political leaders say about what they've done of tax haven and what they have really done. And so this huge gap is, I think, a big danger for democracy.
democracy, because then people get frustrated and get, you know, feel that they are not being told. So, you know, in my country, in France, there was a former president who kept saying that he had, you know, saved the world during the crisis, and in particular, he had, you know, tax haven do not exist anymore after the first G20 summit in 2008. You know, this is what Sarkozy used to say when he was president. And, you know, of course, this made no sense because nothing had been done. So this is, you know, in my country, you know, there was a minister of budget, the first minister of budget of President Hollande, you know, Cahuzac, who had, you know, he had a bank account in Switzerland, and he was supposed to take care of the tax system in France, but he had a bank account in Switzerland on which he was not paying tax. And, you know, he was the minister of a supposedly progressive government. And, you know, this could happen again because, you know, the transmission, automatic transmission of information about cross-border financial assets are not in place yet. Although we are moving in this direction, partly, you know, it is sad to say, I would have preferred European countries to solve the problem on their own, but what solved the problem partly were the US sanctions against Swiss banks, and, you know, the US government can put very strong sanctions on all foreign countries. Sometimes they do it in a strange way, and you know, the decisions made by the U.S. legal system are sometimes very arbitrary. But in this case, they were somewhat useful, and they said, okay, if you don't change your bank secrecy law, you won't have banking license in the U.S. anymore, and then the Swiss government immediately changed their banking law. So what I want to remember from this episode is that, you know, if you have adequate sanctions, you can change tax havens, but you cannot just ask politely to tax havens to stop being tax havens. You know, you need to put sanctions that are in proportion with the benefits that some people and sometimes some countries get from financial opacity.
This is interesting. What do you think about the criticism by Acemoglu and Robinson about the rise and fall of general laws of capitalism?
You know, I was really surprised by this criticism because, you know, I fully agree with them that what really matters is institutions and policies. And, you know, this is what I do during my entire book, is to show that ultimately, you know, what matters for the dynamics of inequality is institutions. So I really don't understand how they could write a paper saying, well, Piketty believes institutions and policies are not important. You know, this was very surprising to me. You know, I think, you know, sometimes in academia you have an incentive to maximize the product differentiation even when there is not really. So I don't know. You know, I think maybe the other reason is that maybe we don't have exactly the same view of institutions. So initially, Acemoglu and Robinson had a view of institutions that was very much centered on property rights and the protection of property rights. You know, so if you have a well-protected property rights, you can grow and develop and become rich. And if you don't, you remain poor, and that's it. Now, you know, my view of institutions, I think, is somewhat broader. You know, so I agree, you know, the rule of law is important, etc. But, you know, you also need progressive taxation, you also need the welfare state, you also need free education. So, you know, I think you need to study institutions with a broader view of institutions that I think what they tend to do. But, you know, I think we disagree maybe less intensively than what they believe. You know, I don't know.
Okay. And I think these are the last two ones. La primera es. La desigualdad conlleva incentivos para el desarrollo. ¿En qué grado es aceptable? ¿Cómo se define su nivel ideal? Si todos tienen asegurado un bienestar social suficiente para desarrollarse, ¿cuál es el problema de que haya desigualdad?
The problem is just that we could do even better. We could improve the well-being of everybody even more. So, you know,
the elite always wants to present inequality as being justified by incentive consideration, growth consideration. Now, sometimes this is true, sometimes it's not true. So we have to put this claim under public scrutiny. And, you know, I think I start my book with a quotation from the Article 1 of the Declaration of Rights of the French Revolution of 1789. And this Article 1 says two things. You know, the first sentence is an absolute proclamation of the principle of equality, so les hommes naissent et demeurent libres et égaux en droit, the men are born equal in rights. And then the second sentence introduces the possibility of inequality and says les distinctions sociales ne peuvent être fondées que sur l'utilité commune. So social distinction must be founded upon common utility. And the way I interpret this sentence is to say, okay, you can have social distinction, you can have social inequality, but only to the extent that they benefit the entire society. So what's common utility, the way I interpret it, is it must benefit the poorest segment in societies. Now, sometimes, and you know, some people associate this to John Rawls, but you know, I think this was, you can find similar principles of justice in many different philosophical and political traditions, including in the Declaration of Rights of 1789. So I think, you know, we need to see, you know, in a very concrete manner, you know, how much inequality can be justified by growth. And you know, I think sometimes, you know, the discourse of the elite to promote to justify inequality is just not convincing at all. So we, you know, there's a lot of hypocrisy. You know, I mentioned the French elite before 1914, where basically they believed, I don't know if it's a little bit like Acemoglu Robinson, but they tend to believe that with the protection of property right and people being equal under the right of property, you know, that's enough to create a society of equal, and whatever the concentration of wealth you have is fine. And you know, I think this was there was a lot of hypocrisy in this belief. You know, I think the level of inequality that we had in European societies until 1914 was not useful for growth. It was reduced enormously by very violent shocks. World War I, the Great Depression, World War II, and also by the new social and fiscal policies that were finally accepted by the elite after these shocks, but that were refused until 1914. And in the end, there was much less inequality in 1950, 1960s, and in 1910. And this was certainly not bad for growth. You know, probably this induced even bigger growth because it induced more mobility. The problem with extreme inequality is that it tends to lead to high perpetuation of inequality over time. And, you know, if you look in Latin America today, you know, it's quite possible that the level of inequality is above, you know, any level that you can justify on the basis of growth consideration and incentive considerations. You know, the fact that in Brazil, you pay a very high indirect tax, 30% tax rate on your electricity bill and 4% tax rate on inheritance, you know, is it useful for growth? You know, I'm not so sure. You know, I think the very high inequality and very indirect tax system and regressive tax systems that you have sometimes in Latin America, you know, I don't think that it is so useful for growth. So, you know, we have to put these claims under public scrutiny. You know, what's interesting is that the very wealthy, you know, at least they never justify inequality, at least in public discourse, just by saying, okay, this is good for me, this is bad for the poor, too bad for them. Okay, they never say that. They always say, well, inequality, you know, that's also good for the poor because that's good for growth. So at least this shows that in the domain of public discourse, we all accept certain norms and we all accept the views that inequality must be justified by common utility. Then people, of course, can be very dishonest and very, you know, in the justification and the argument, but at least it means that people seem to accept common rules about the kind of arguments we can exchange about inequality.
Okay. In a world with so much wealth inequality, thank you for sharing your human capital with us. Thanks a lot. Thank you.